we're still 5 minutes early. Everyone finished their tea too fast. You saved my seat. I don't care. There's still a couple of people out there drinking tea. Not very many, though. Huh? It's probably not. It's pretty obvious what I'm talking about. I've already been formally announced and thanked, so I think I can. All right. Why don't we go ahead and get started? That way, if I run over, you know, we'll have plenty of time. So, follow up with the previous excellent talk, which described the hardware of the microscope and how imaging occurs there, with a little bit on the image processing side of things. So, we'll take the concepts of CTF and look at how we deal with them once the images have been collected and get into the computer. And I'll relate it a little bit back to the hardware, the focus primarily will be more on the math and the software. Hopefully not too much math, but a little bit. Can everyone hear me in the back? Is it okay? Okay. So very much like Fourier transforms, which we talked about yesterday, I said are everywhere. They're ubiquitous. They're in nature. They're not just a mathematical invention. The same thing could be said of a Gaussian distribution. So this is just the standard bell-shaped curve that you've seen in statistics, that sort of thing. These are also all over the place in nature. We could easily spend an hour talking about Gaussians, and I would probably find that a lot of fun, but you might not. So I think we'll stick to sort of the basics here. Gaussian distribution is just a simple e to the minus x squared with some sort of a width. W defines the width of the function. One of the most interesting properties of Gaussians, and one way of defining the Gaussian, is the fact that the Fourier transform of a Gaussian is also a Gaussian. So a Gaussian is the one functional form which remains unchanged when it goes through a Fourier transform operation. And this is a very important property of these Gaussians, because it means that makes certain operations with them invertible. Now, the one thing that does change when you take the Fourier transform of Gaussian is there's a reciprocal relationship, very much like the reciprocal relationships we were looking at yesterday, which means if the Gaussian is narrow in real space, when we look at the Fourier transform of the Gaussian, it gets wider, and vice versa. The wider it is in real space, the narrower it is in Fourier space, and so on. So if the width is W in real space, the width in Fourier space is 2 divided by W. Now that makes a lot of sense if you think about it. So if you think about a Gaussian as sort of a blurring operation in real space, if it's a very narrow Gaussian in real space, that means that it's not blurring very much. Okay? So that would correspond to preserving a very wide Gaussian in Fourier space, meaning you're preserving information all the way up to high spatial frequencies, out to high resolution. So remember, in Fourier space, this is low resolution, and then as we go to larger and larger distances from the origin, we're talking about higher and higher resolutions or finer and finer features. So if we don't blur the image very much, if we have a narrow Gaussian real space, then we preserve all the high resolution features. If the Gaussian is very broad in real space, if we're blurring things a lot in real space, that corresponds to getting rid of all the high resolution features, so it gets narrow in Fourier space, and vice versa. So we now need to talk about this concept of convolution, which was introduced very briefly before. I'll introduce it again very briefly. The idea behind convolution is fairly simple, but sometimes takes a little while to wrap your head around. So let's say we have one function, and we want to convolve that with another function. Okay, so this is a very simple function. It's zero everywhere, except here it's 1, and here it's 2, and here it's 1 with minus 1 in the next value. So it's just a discrete valued function. Now we want to convolve this function with this function, which is minus 1, 2, minus 1. Basically, all we do is we take this function and we plop it down, we multiply it by whatever value we have here, and we plop a copy of that function down in space there. Right? So here, where we had a 1, we just put an exact copy there. Here, where we had a 2, we put the copy of the function there, but it's twice as big. It's been multiplied by 2. And here, where we have a plus 1 minus 1, we have the sum of this function with the sum of minus 1 times that function right next to it, and then those are added together. Okay? So this is the way blurring operations occur in images. So if you take a function like this, and we convolved it with a Gaussian curve, it would basically blur out each of these peaks that we saw here and smear them together in space. Mathematically, that's expressed like this. So we have the continuous convolution operation, and here's the discrete convolution operation with the sum. But conceptually, really, this is all that's going on. It's pretty straightforward. Now, one of the really interesting things about convolutions is their relationship to Fourier space. The way you can easily convolve, so if you want to do a convolution in real space like this, it's expensive to do computationally. You have to go through every pixel in this image and then multiply it by the corresponding image that you have over here. This image could occupy all of space, so you have to go through all n pixels here, and for each of the n pixels here, you have to go through all n pixels here, so it's what you'd call an order n squared operation. It takes n squared operations to compute it. So it's very slow and very expensive. Fourier transforms can be computed very quickly via an algorithm called the fast Fourier transform. They can be computed, instead of order n squared time, they can be computed in order n log n time. So there's a logarithm involved there which makes the computation much faster. So if we can do something in Fourier space, generally it's computationally efficient to do so. Turns out that a convolution operation in Fourier space is just a multiplication. So all I do is I take the Fourier transform, so when I use the capital letters with the bar over the top, that's the Fourier transform of the function. So here we have h of x, that's the real space function. Here we have capital H of k, this is the Fourier transform of that function. So this indicates real space convolution, and in Fourier space, all I do is I multiply the Fourier transform of this function by the Fourier transform of this function, and that gives me the Fourier transform of the convolution. I was also saying yesterday that Fourier transforms are a sort of dual system. There's a duality. If you do anything in one space, it has an effect on the other space, you can invert that relationship. That means if we multiply by something in real space, it has the effect of doing a convolution in the other space. So if instead of multiplying by two functions together in Fourier space to cause a convolution in real space, I could multiply by something in real space and cause a convolution in Fourier space. Now, why is that important? Let's say you do something in real space like a mask. Okay, so I have my particle and there's a lot of noise present around the particle and I want to mask out the noise and I'll set all the noise to zero. The way I do that is I multiply the real space image by a mask function, and the effect of that in Fourier space is to do a convolution with the Fourier transform of the shape of the mask. Okay? Well, this takes a little bit of time to wrap your head around. It's something that you'll have to play with a little while before you really get, but let's take a look at some examples just to better understand. So what I'm going to use for my examples is this test image on the right. The reason I use this as a test image is it has lots of directional features. It's sort of circularly symmetric in a sense, and it has lots of sharp edges, so we can see the effects in sharp edges. And then I have this little bar on the top, which has a more gradual change, so we can see what happens when we encounter sharp edges, and we can also see what happens when we have gradual gradients in the image. Okay, so there's nothing magical about this image other than that. It just has lots of useful features. So what I want to do is I want to take this image and filter it in various ways. And when I say filter, what I mean is I perform a convolution operation. So if I want to perform a convolution operation with a Gaussian, what I have to do is I have to go to Fourier space and multiply the Fourier transform of the image by the Fourier transform of a Gaussian. And as I just said, the Fourier transform of a Gaussian is also just a Gaussian, so it's the same shape. So what I'm showing you here is the Fourier transform of the Gaussian that I've multiplied the Fourier transform of this image by. Now, you'll note this isn't an image, it's just a one-dimensional function, so it's rotationally symmetric. Okay, so I'm doing the same multiplication in all directions, so I'm uniformly smearing in all directions. if I did it in a directional way, then obviously I would smear in one direction and I'd keep things sharp in the other direction, which isn't desirable normally. Okay, so by multiplying by this Gaussian, I have obviously just blurred my image out. Very straightforward. Now, you don't have to use a Gaussian as a low-pass filter. You can use other functions as low-pass filters. So here we have this nice smooth Gaussian falloff, and we have this nice uniform blurring occurring. What if we use, a so-called step function as a filter? Okay, so this is imposing a sharp cutoff in Fourier space. This isn't the real space function we're looking at here. This is the Fourier space function. So basically, we're keeping everything out to some resolution. In this case, about a quarter of the way to Nyquist frequency. Nyquist frequency is the highest resolution that exists in your image, and it's 0.5 here. So I'm throwing away basically three quarters of the information in my image, and I'm just keeping this low resolution information. The issue is that since we have a sharp edge here, the Fourier if you remember yesterday when we looked at the Fourier transform of a step function, it had all these ripples in it. So that's what we're seeing over here. You can see all these ripples coming off the edge of all of the sharp edges present in the image. Now I'm going to take this exact same thing, and I'm just going to increase the brightness so you can see it a little bit more clearly. Now something you'll notice is that we have all these circular ripples coming off the edge of the at sign here. Look at the top here. There are these edges coming in from the top. So if you remember, Fourier transforms, finite Fourier transforms like we're doing here, have periodic boundary conditions. That means we're not really looking at an at sign in space. We're looking at an infinite number of at signs tiled in space. So there isn't just an at sign here. There's another at sign up here. And the at sign up here has ripples coming off the bottom of it. And those ripples are extending into the box here. That's an effect known as aliasing. And it occurs all over the image. And yesterday when we were doing the practical, I mentioned that it was important that you use a large enough box size when you do your image processing. A lot of the operations we do when we do CTF correction, that sort of thing, operate in Fourier space. And you have these effects where neighboring unit cells can come into the image and impact your reconstruction. So if you do some CTF correction and it causes ripples like this to appear or get corrected in the image, you could impact the particle itself if it's not far enough away from the edge of the box. Now, there's a trade-off. So we have this sharp, I showed you the Gaussian filter, and I showed you the sharp filter. So there's another type of filter known as a Butterworth filter, which was developed by electrical engineers, basically, which is sort of a trade-off between the two. It's still kind of sharp, but it has a slightly soft edge, and the slightly soft edge allows you to reduce the effect of the ripples. So it doesn't blur things out quite as much as the Gaussian filter did, but it still has a little bit of a ripple effect. So it's not perfect. And you can adjust the width of this fall-off to make it more blurry but have fewer ripples, or have more ripples and make it sharper. So this is another type of filter which is often used in image processing. Now in E-MAN specifically, we're using Gaussian filters. For all of the normal procedures we use Gaussian filters because they have a lot of nice properties. But all of these other filters are available optionally as well. Okay, now what we've been looking at so far is a so-called low-pass filter. What that means is we throw away the high frequencies, the high resolution, and we keep the low frequencies. That's why it's called a low-pass filter. It passes the low frequencies. There's another type of filter called a high-pass filter. So in this case, it's the same function. It's a Gaussian, but we've taken 1 minus that function. So now it's throwing away everything at low resolution, and it's keeping the stuff at high resolution. And the effect of that on the image is it does a sort of edge detection process. So you can see here where we had our gradual gradient, it's basically completely eliminated all of the features. But wherever we have a very sharp edge, it preserves that sharp edge and enhances it. This is very similar to what would happen when you do an edge detection filter in Photoshop or something like that. It's doing something equivalent to this operation, although often that's performed in real space rather than Fourier space. And again, you can perform different types of high-pass filters which will have different effects on the sharpness of the edges and that sort of thing. High-pass filters are used, but only in a very weak form when you're doing cryo-EM image processing. Very often when you collect a micrograph, there are these ice gradients that are present in the image. We talked about this a little bit yesterday, which cause this sharp peak at very low resolution. And you can often get slightly better alignments and the image processing just goes better if you get rid of those gradients. So it's very common to perform a little bit of a high-pass filter just at very, very low resolution to get rid of some of those things. We don't want to wipe out any of the internal features of our structure. We just want to get rid of the ice gradients, which aren't part of the structure. All right, so back to our test image again. What I want to do now is talk about deconvolution. Okay, so what's deconvolution? So in this situation, we have blurred the image, right? So I've taken the Fourier transform of my image, and I have multiplied it by the Fourier transform of Gaussian, which is another Gaussian. Okay, great. Now, it seems logical to assume that I could undo that blurring operation if I wanted to. Since all I did was multiply by this function in Fourier space, it doesn't ever actually go all the way to zero. It asymptotically approaches zero, but it never quite gets all the way to zero. So I still theoretically have all that information present in my image. So it seems like I should be able to recover it. All I would have to do is divide by this function instead of multiply by this function. And in fact, you can do that. So if I divide by that function, I can get back my original image again. So what I did is I multiplied by this function, which is the reciprocal of the other function. Now it's e to the x squared instead of e to the minus x squared, right? It's not quite as perfect as it looks, though. If we zoom in a little bit here, you'll see that in the recovered function, there's all this high-frequency noise that's present there. It was a little difficult to see in the original image. So it's not quite a perfect reconstruction. And of course, the reason for that is that if you probably can't read the numbers here. They're pretty big. But this is 4 million, 6 million, 8 million. We're multiplying the small values by very large numbers. So if there's any little numerical roundoff error or any residual noise present, it's going to massively amplify that noise when we do this deconvolution process, once the values get small. We're probably OK if we deconvolute it out to here, but once we get out to here, we might be in trouble. Now, this is important because when we do CTF correction, or if you've read a lot of read cryo-EM papers, you'll often hear them say, after we solved the structure, we did an inverse b-factor correction to our map with some b-factor number. What they're talking about doing when they say an inverse b-factor correction or something like that is what we're looking at here. It's a deconvolution with a Gaussian to sharpen the map a little bit. Now, they're not sharpening it quite to the extent that I sharpened it here. They're sharpening it to extent at which the noise doesn't get amplified. Now, why do they call it a b-factor correction? So if you're familiar with crystallography at all, in crystallography, there's something that's known as the crystallographic b-factor. So every atom in the crystal structure will have a number called a b-factor associated with it. That b-factor corresponds to an estimate of how much each atom is vibrating within the crystal. So when you solve the crystal structure and you look at the density map of the crystal structure, the atoms will be localized, but some of them are better localized than others. So if it's less localized, the assumption is that in all the unit cells in the crystal, those atoms are moving around a little bit. Some move around a lot, some move around a little. And this is one of those places where Gaussians mysteriously emerge. If you assume that the vibration of the atom is harmonic, if it's undergoing a local harmonic oscillation in position, it produces a Gaussian distribution in space. So the B factor is basically talking about how much of a Gaussian smear is going on for each atom in a crystal structure. In cryo-EM, when we talk about B factors, we're not talking about atomic temperature, the Debye-Waller temperature factors. We're talking about experimental B factors. This is a B factor which is derived from the properties of the microscope, the MTF of the microscope, the envelope function that we heard about recently, and that sort of thing. So it's still estimated to be a Gaussian overall, but it's not relating to the individual atoms. So if you know some crystallography and you're thinking, oh, B factors, he's talking about something I'm familiar with. No, you're not. It's not the same B factor. They're both Gaussians, but other than that, they're not the same thing. Okay, now there's another problem with this. So often this arises in cop TV shows or movies. You see these cop movies, and they take a picture, this blurry picture of a license plate in a car, and they take it to the image processing expert, and they magically make it this beautiful thing, and they can read the license plate perfectly and stuff like that. So this is more or less what they're doing there, right? They're taking a blurry image, and they're sharpening it again, and they're pulling out the license plate. So why is that not really practical? I mean, that concept does exist, obviously, but why is that not always possible? Well, the main reason it's not possible is if instead of doing this with a real-valued function. So the image that I was doing that test on, I had a floating-point number. I had a four-byte floating-point number at each pixel location. right? So each pixel, I had a 24 bits of information present. I had, you know, millions of different values present for each pixel. When you take real images with a typical digital camera or a webcam or something like that, you have a much smaller number of discrete values. For each pixel, typically you'll only have 8 bits, so 256 different values. If I do exactly the same test, instead of using a floating point image, I use an image that only has 256 different gray values, the sort of implicit uncertainty that's associated with that resolution of the image makes the deconvolution turn out like this. Okay, so instead of getting this very nice original we lose everything. So if you want to do that kind of sharpening, you have to use iterative algorithms, and you have to be very careful about how much you sharpen and that sort of thing. So this is just to say that if you're doing these sort of mathematical operations in Fourier space, it's necessary to preserve. That's why we don't use integral pixel values. That's why we use floating point numbers for our pixels. Okay, now let's move on a little bit to talking about noise. Now, it would be lovely if we could subtract noise from the image. But of course, you can't subtract noise because, well, it's noise. If the numbers are random, there's no way to subtract them away. In Fourier terms, you would say that we can characterize the amplitudes of the noise, but we don't have any phase information about it, so there's no way we can get rid of it in that way. But we can characterize it. We can characterize the Fourier amplitudes. We can characterize how much noise is present at each frequency or each resolution. So if we look at the Fourier transform of an image that contains white noise, we'll see something like this. So this is what's known as a power spectrum of the image. We take the Fourier transform of the image, and then we rotationally average it, and we do sort of a one-dimensional radial plot. So this is low resolution, this is high resolution, and you can see it's basically flat. It's got some noise in it because, well, it's noise, so there's random fluctuations, but it's basically a flat distribution, and this is what's known as white noise. It's known as white because if you look at, say, the light spectrum, the light spectrum corresponds to different frequencies, different wavelengths, and if they're uniform, if you have white light, that basically is a uniform weighting of all of the different frequencies of light. So here we have a uniform distribution of the frequencies of noise. When you have white noise, it also is uncorrelated noise. That means that the pixel values are all independently noisy from one another. Now, we don't normally have white noise in electron micrographs. Usually we have something that's termed pink noise. Now, it's called pink noise for the similar reason that white noise is called white noise. That is, we have a bias towards the red end of the spectrum. The low resolution end, there's more signal, and then there's less signal at high resolution, but there's still some white noise present as well. So it's red averaged with white, which makes it pink. This isn't a cryo-EM thing. This is an electrical engineering thing. But that's really what it's called. So pink noise is still noise, but it's a little blurry. It's been convolved with a little bit of an envelope function, which smears it together. Okay, so the question we want to ask, if we're going to try and do an optimal reconstruction in the presence of a lot of noise, is if we have, so we have a perfect image here, and we're adding white noise to the image, which gives us this noisy image. Now, what we'd like to be able to do is take a noisy image like this and modify it in some way to make it look as much like this as we possibly can. Now, there is noise present, so we're not going to be able to perfectly get back this. We can't separate the signal from the noise in any perfect fashion. But if we can estimate how much signal and how much noise there is at each frequency, we can compensate for it to some extent, and we can try and make our image look like that. Okay, so this mathematically is what we're doing. Okay, the idea is we want to minimize the least squared difference between this image and this image. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this image and I'm going to apply some unknown filter function. I'm going to convolve it with some function in Fourier space, which I still have to define, to filter it to make it look as much like this as possible in a least squared sense. So I want to have the difference between each pixel here and each pixel here minimized after I filtered it. Okay, so I have this unknown filter function f here. Unknown filter function c here. F is the Fourier transform of the image, and this is the filtered Fourier transform of the image. Now, I'm not going to take you through the derivation of this. It's mathematical. It's 3 or 4 pages long. It's not worth going through. But there is an optimal solution to the problem, and the optimal solution to this problem is the filter function is equal to That is the filter function. That is the image. The filter function that you get is 1 over 1 plus 1 over the signal-to-noise ratio. That function is also known as a Wiener filter. So if you've seen the term Wiener filter before, that's what it is. And the Wiener filter looks like this. Now, this isn't what I've been showing before. This isn't Fourier space that we're looking at here. This is a relationship between signal-to-noise ratio and how much of a filter we're applying. So what you have to do here is you have to go to Fourier space, and you have to look at your Fourier transform here and estimate what the signal-to-noise ratio is at each point in this curve. And then it goes through this transformation, and that tells you how much filtration you do at each point in space. So it's an adaptive filter. Okay? So we have to have some way of estimating the signal-to-noise ratio to do this. Okay, now when we do this to an electron micrograph, we can look at our particle. These are single particle images of Groeyel. You can see they're difficult to see. We can see sort of the stripe pattern here. That's one side view. This is a top view of the particle. We can estimate the signal-to-noise ratio, and then we can apply the Wiener filter, and we get something like this. So now you can see the particles are much easier to see, and the noise is greatly reduced. Now you'd say, well, I do see a lot of other stuff, lumpy stuff in the background stuff. That's actually real stuff in the image. So here, this is like a piece of another Groeyel particle that's sort of stuck on the side here, and this is another particle stuck over here. It turns out this image was actually really crowded. You just couldn't tell that it was really crowded when you looked at the original raw micrograph. So all the stuff that we're seeing over here is real stuff, not just noise. All right. Let's move on now and talk a little bit about CTF and MTF, and then that'll relate back to the convolution and deconvolution stuff that we just talked about. So you'll see these two terms used, and sometimes they're used in inconsistent ways. So CTF stands for contrast transfer function. And from theoretical terms, that normally just refers to the weak phase approximation, the sine gamma, the oscillatory function that we saw in the previous talk. There's an additional term which is called the modulation transfer function, MTF, and that's sort of an aggregate of what happens when the specimen moves in the beam, what effect the detector has on the measured image, the envelope function of the microscope itself. All of these factors get sort of convolved together and go into the MTF. Sometimes you'll see people refer to the MTF of the microscope or the MTF of the detector as separate things. Now, the confusing bit is when people talk about doing CTF correction of an image, very often they're referring to both the CTF and the MTF. So if you hear these terms, just understand that CTF may be referring to just the CTF, just the oscillatory phase behavior of the microscope, or it may be referring to some combination of these two things. All right, so let's look at an image and evaluate the image. So here's a typical micrograph. Of course, typical means very carefully hand-selected, but here's a typical micrograph. We're going to take a Fourier transform of this micrograph, and it looks like this. And we see the pattern of rings that we also saw in the previous talk. So these rings are, of course, due to the imaging optics of the microscope itself. It has nothing to do with the specimen that we're looking at, right? So this is an imaging artifact that we're seeing that causes these rings. The next thing we'll do is we'll take the rings and we'll do a rotational average to get a one-dimensional power spectrum. And if we look at the power spectrum, we can very nicely see this oscillatory behavior. Now, something you'll notice in this power spectrum is it looks kind of noisy, right? It has this oscillatory behavior, but the curve itself has a lot of noise in it. So typically, when you evaluate a micrograph, you don't take the FFT of the whole image. What we want to do is we want to sort of smooth this curve out. And the way that's generally accomplished is by chopping the micrograph up into small pieces. So if we take the Fourier transform of this whole image, it's 4K by 4K, the Fourier transform that we get is also going to have a 2K radius. Okay? It's going to be as big as the original image was, basically. It'll only be half, but that's kind of a separate issue. Instead, I don't really need all of that detail. I don't need to have 2,000 different points in my power spectrum. So what I'll do instead is I'll box out these little, say, 512 or 256 boxes from the overall micrograph, and then I'll take the power spectrum of each box, and then I'll average those power spectra together, which gives me fewer points in my curve, but it makes those points much smoother. So now my curve looks a little bit nicer. So that's typically how whole micrographs get evaluated, is by chopping them up into pieces like that. All right, now what do we have here? What are we looking at? So you'll see there is an oscillatory curve here, but there's also this kind of smooth fall off that isn't oscillating. Okay, so we could actually fit a line through here. So if you remember the shape of the CTF function that we saw in the previous talk, it goes through zero at certain locations. Now what we're looking at here isn't amplitude, what we're looking at here is intensity. So it's amplitude squared. So we're not looking at sine x, we're looking at, or sine s, we're looking at sine s squared. Okay, so all those negative things are becoming positive peaks, and these points right here are the places where the curve goes through zero. But clearly it's not actually going through zero, so something else is going on in here. The something else that's going on there is noise. And the noise may have a variety of different sources. It may come from the detector. It may come from inelastic scattering in the microscope. It may be shot noise. So there's a variety of different sources of noise. But in this model, we are considering anything that doesn't have this oscillatory pattern to be noise, and anything that does have the oscillatory pattern to be signal. We'll talk about how that's not completely correct in a few slides, but it's a starting point anyway. So once we've estimated that background, we can then subtract the background away, and that gives us this nice intensity curve, background subtracted intensity curve, and now we can see our CTF oscillations very nicely, and we can see how far out these ripples go, and you can see they're actually going all the way out to Nyquist in this particular case, so it's a nice quality image. Now this is a low resolution image. It was collected on a 200 keV microscope, may not have even had a field emission gun, but still it's got signal going out to 6 angstroms or so. Now if we fit the function, the CTF function that we saw in the last talk, if we overlay that on our black curve, you'll see that it doesn't match the curve properly. Okay? The reason for that is that what we're seeing isn't just the CTF. What we're seeing is the specimen, whatever is present in the image, multiplied by the CTF. Okay? So what we're actually seeing when we look at one of these curves, we're measuring, this M here is the measured curve, so that's the black line there. And that consists of several components. F of S here is the structure factor of the specimen. What that means is if we had a perfect specimen, if we knew exactly, you know, if we had the perfect specimen, if we had the true image without any noise, without any CTF or anything like that, and we took its Fourier transform, that would be F. Okay? Then we have the contrast transfer function and envelope function here. So the F is getting multiplied by that, and then there's some additive noise that we put in here too. And the noise will have some functional form that we can characterize. So we're seeing the true image multiplied by the CTF with the added noise. Now, once we have that concept, we can immediately begin to estimate the spectral signal-to-noise ratio. So what does signal-to-noise ratio mean? Signal-to-noise ratio is exactly what it sounds like. It is a ratio of signal to noise. Okay? So if you have a signal-to-noise ratio of 1, that means that you have an equal amount of signal and an equal amount of signal and noise present in the image. If you have a signal-to-noise ratio of 100, you have 100 times more signal than noise, and you probably won't see any visible noise. If you have a signal-to-noise ratio of 0.01, you have 100 times more noise than signal, and you won't see anything. You'll just see noise if you look at the image. Okay? So 1 is typically used as sort of a threshold value where the noise and signal are about equal, and you can still see what you're looking for, but it looks pretty noisy visibly. So we can now estimate that. All we have to do is take the measured curve, subtract what we're assuming is noise down here, this background away from it, and then divide by the noise curve, right? So signal divided by noise. And now we can estimate at each spatial frequency how much we have. Why is this useful? Well, we just looked at Wiener filters. So if we want to do a Wiener filter, we need to know that signal-to-noise ratio so we know how much to filter at each point. If we're here, for example, where it's all noise and there's zero signal, well, we want to completely remove that from the final image. We filter that out. So the Wiener filter goes to zero at these points. Whereas if we're here and the signal-to-noise ratio is something closer to 1, we'll only apply a mild filter there. So we apply a filter sort of related to the amount of signal that's present at each frequency. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about the CTF correction process. So we saw this equation in the last talk as well. This is the primary thing that we're worrying about here. So we have this sine cosine term. So this is the phase contrast. This is the amplitude contrast. The Q is the coefficient defining how much amplitude contrast you have. So this is typically set to about 10%. So in this equation, it would be 0.1. And then we have this definition here of gamma, which tells us how much of a phase shift we have here in our sine and in our cosine function. So we have, our measured image. We have the Fourier transform of the perfect ideal particle. That gets multiplied by a CTF. It gets multiplied by an envelope function. Our envelope function here, we're just estimating as being a pure Gaussian, even though some of the terms that go into it aren't perfectly Gaussian. We have our noise. And then here's the definition of the other variables. Amplitude contrast, we have our spherical aberration. We have the wavelength of the electrons. We have the defocus. And then S is the x-axis in Fourier space, spatial frequency. Okay. Let's take a look at this a little bit more thoroughly. All right, so I'm going to start by just doing some very simple simulations of contrast transfer function. Now, the font is probably a little small. It's okay if you. I'll try and tell you what it says when I adjust it. I did this so we have enough space to actually see some of these other windows pretty well. All right, maybe I'll make that a little bigger. All right, so what we're looking at here is just a simple simulation of the contrast transfer function of the microscope. So I can adjust all of the parameters over here. I've got defocus, B factor, then defocus difference in angle for adjusting astigmatism, percent amplitude contrast, angstrom per pixel, voltage, C sub S, et cetera. I can adjust all these parameters. The amplitude contrast will set it, say, 10%. All right. Now, if the amplitude contrast is zero, you'll note that the function is zero at the origin here. And this is what we heard about in the last talk. You don't have any low-resolution contrast if you don't have something to produce it. If we have a little bit of amplitude contrast, which is present in the specimen, in other words, the specimen isn't a pure phase object, it also absorbs some electrons, then we get a little bit of contrast at low resolution caused by that. As I adjust the defocus, if I go closer to focus, it goes like that, and if I go farther from focus, it goes like that. So the main effect that we see here is you can see this first maximum. So this first maximum right now is at 15 angstrom resolution. When you look at a molecule, most of the interesting low-resolution features that define the quaternary structure of the molecule are between sort of 20 angstroms and about 80 angstrom resolution. Okay? So what we're looking for is in this range is where we have sort of the contrast that lets you see that the particle is there. Then this range are sort of the intermediate resolution features, then we have the higher resolution features, and then now here we're going all the way out to 2 angstrom resolution. So maybe I should limit the range of this a little bit, but it's fine. Okay, so this would be where we'd be interested in enhancing the contrast to find the particles. So if we go further from focus, you can see what that does is it shifts this first maximum towards the origin and allows us to basically improve the contrast of our micrograph. Now, the cost that we pay for that is the fact that these oscillations get closer and closer together, and it becomes harder and harder to deal with the CTF. In addition, there's a weak relationship between the defocus and the B factor. So in a typical optical microscope, when you go out of focus, it blurs the image. That also happens a little bit in an electron microscope, but the effect is much weaker. So when I go far from focus, I will also see a little bit of this occurring, killing my high-resolution signal, but it's not a super strong effect. It's a sort of a modest effect. Okay, so we have this trade-off that we have to deal with here. If I go really close to focus, if I go to Schetzer defocus here, I can get to the point where I don't have to do much CTF correction because my first zero crossing doesn't occur till like 3 angstroms. But I've lost all of my low-resolution contrast, and it's going to be very hard to see anything. Okay, if I go further from focus, then I have to deal with CTF correction a lot more strongly, but I enhance my contrast. So it's a trade-off between these two things. Now, something I'm not showing here also is noise, right? So we haven't considered that. So let's take a look a little bit more carefully now at the point spread function. So I'm going to add another window to the simulation here. And we won't be able to see the actual dot because it's literally just a dot in space. So what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be simulating the convolution that occurs when you combine this CTF function with a real image. Where did my window go? There it is. All right. So this is the function that I'm dealing with. And right now, you probably just see a gray screen. In reality, there is a dot right in the middle there, which you should be able to see now. So there is one pixel that has a non-zero value. So when we talk about the point spread function, that's why it's called a point spread function. It's called a point spread function because we have one point in space, also known as a delta function, which is non-zero. And then we look to then we go into Fourier space and we convolve that with something, and then we look at what effect it has in real space. So when we convolve that with this CTF, we get something like this, which actually looks kind of similar to what the CTF looks like in Fourier space. As I play with the defocus, you can see, as I go further from focus, these ripples extend out farther and farther from the origin. Okay? As I go closer to focus, it gets more and more condensed, and if I get really close to focus, I still can't quite get it to a point, right? Because I my Fourier transform, CTF still has this sort of complicated behavior. So I can never get the perfect point back again by doing this. At least I can't get it back unless I play some sort of a trick, like I set the C sub S to zero, and then if I go all the way into focus, I can get very close to having a point back again. But of course, I normally am not going to have a C sub S of zero, although it is possible to by a microscope. I'll actually talk about that a little bit later. Okay, so this is the effect of the contrast transfer function on a single point in space. So if you have a real image, that means that every point in the real image is getting convolved with this very complicated ringing sort of pattern. So let's take a look at that. Okay, so what we're going to look at here is a single projection of the beta galactosidase molecule that we're doing in the tutorial sessions in the afternoon. We still have our simulation function here, of course. That window is always hiding. There it is. Okay, so the perfect projection looks like that. Auto contrast, okay? So that's the perfect projection. There's no noise present here. This is just a test of sort of a pure simulated image, okay? If I modify that by the CTF, it looks like that. If I play with the defocus, you can see what impact that has on the image. And look, as I go farther from focus here, you can now, if you look carefully, you can see these rings coming in from the right edge of the image, which are distorting it's actually extending into the molecule itself and causing little distortions. Okay? This is the impact of trying to do CTF correction when you're far from focus and the box is too small. Okay? You get all of these horrible effects. Okay? If we're close to focus, it's not quite so severe, but there's still an effect there. Now, again, the thing that I'm not showing here is I'm not showing you any noise. So what really happens if I get too close to focus here is that the particle will look like this, but it'll get overwhelmed by noise because it's getting weaker and weaker as we go. I'm not going to try and do the noise simulation today. Okay? So just keep in mind that there's a limit to how close to focus we can get. So if we go really far from focus, we need to do something about that. We need to correct all those phases to pull all of this information back where it belongs again in the image. All right. Now, a lot of people do negative stain. That may be because you don't have a cryomicroscope yet. It may just be because negative stain is easier. A lot of people do negative stain. And I very frequently get asked this question of, I'm doing negative stain. Should I bother doing any CTF correction or not? Okay. Well, let's take a look at the question. All right. So here is, again, my simulated particle. This is what that particle would look like with six different defocus values, ranging from 1 micron to 2 microns. Okay. So what we're going to do now is we'll just take all of those and we'll average them together. Okay. We average them together, we get something that looks like that. If we take the original projection and we low-pass filter it to 20 angstroms, actually that was something I probably should have shown you over here. Let me go back here really quickly. Okay, so we're looking at one defocus here. Now I'm going to overlay a few different defocuses. If I try and do CTF correction, on this, I'm going to have a real problem because the CTF goes through zero here. I have no information at this resolution, or this resolution, or this resolution. And when I'm close to these resolutions right in here, I have very little information. So if I want to be able to do a reconstruction and correct for the CTF, I can't divide by this curve. I can't multiply by the reciprocal of this curve because it goes to infinity at those points. So I need to combine information from multiple defocuses. So what I do is I take one image there, and I take another image there, and I take another image there, and I take another image there. And in aggregate, I hopefully get enough information that I can reconstruct all of my particle. If instead of looking at this, if we look at intensities, and then we add together all of the intensities, we see something like this. So you can see with the specific defocuses I picked, there's still one frequency in here where I'm not getting very good information. So I could maybe play with my defocus a little bit here, and I could fill that one in a little better. Oh, there's another one here. Okay, so now we need maybe add another defocus. So we need to collect images over a wide range of different defocuses to try and fill in all of the information at all spatial frequencies. Okay. So that's what we've tried to do here. We've summed up a bunch of different defocuses without doing any correction at all. So I didn't do any phase flipping correction or anything like that. I just averaged them together. So this should be okay, you would think, out to the resolution where we have our first phase flipping event occur. Right? So all of those different defocuses, there was a first maximum, and there was a point at which the farthest from focus of those images first crossed zero. Below that spatial frequency, all of those peaks were positive, so there was no phase flipping, there was nothing, there was just a little bit of a high pass and a low pass filter applied, so I should be able to get a good reconstruction. If I don't do anything at all, if I just average them together, I get this, and that compares to this. So if we take the original original projection and I low pass filter it to that point at which the phases are bad, 20 angstroms in this case, I see that. Now if we compare that to that, you can see there are some pretty distinct differences between those two structures. Most of those differences are caused by the residual phases, some of which are negative and some of which are positive, that are present in the image. Because I didn't low-pass filter these particles at all. Now, if I take the particles, if I take this, and I low-pass filter it as well, the situation is better. But it's still not perfect. If you look in here, for example, you can see there's a little bit of detail in here. And if I look at what we get from the average of those defocuses, it's still got some CTF artifacts there, mostly due to the high-pass, low-pass filter behavior of the image. So my answer to the question is, do you have to do CTF correction? You don't have to do CTF correction. You can still get something which is pretty much correct if you just low-pass filter your data to the correct resolution, but you can still get a slightly better result if you do CTF correction. It's not going to extend your resolution, it's just going to improve the correctness of the structure. And with most software nowadays, doing CTF correction doesn't cost you very much at all, time or effort or anything like that. Once you know how to do it, it takes just a few minutes to deal with it, so you might as well go ahead and do it. It's not gonna hurt anything, it's only gonna make things better. All right, now this is a somewhat dated structure that I'm going to be talking about here, but it's a very good example still of things we can do on a particle basis. So when we've been talking about CTF so far, we've been talking about CTF from a whole micrograph perspective. There are things we can do with CTF on a particle basis as well, and this is a partial justification for why we might want to do that. So this is an example from basically 2001, so about 15 years ago. So about 15 years ago, a bunch of different groups were all struggling to solve the structure of IP3 receptor. Our group was one of them, so I don't mind using this example because I'm criticizing myself as well. So three different structures were all published at the same time. Technically, there was also a fourth. Three different structures were all published at basically the same time, and they looked like this. As you can see, these three structures, which are ostensibly the same object, do not look anything like one another. This was obviously a cause of some consternation in the community. Everyone who published one of those thought that our structure must be right and the other two structures must be wrong, but no one could really prove it. So this situation persisted for quite some time. It's a very difficult specimen to purify. Membrane proteins are hard to work with. So in 2011, Irina Serasheva, who was the main person in this project, her group was the lead in this project, had spent about 5 years trying to improve her purification conditions and really get a better specimen out. And she got a better specimen, and we imaged the better specimen and did a new reconstruction, and we got something that looked like that. Okay, that doesn't look anything like any of those three previously published structures. Needless to say, when you publish that and you say, ah, now we've got it right, you have a hard time convincing reviewers that, ah, we've got it right. So at that time, we did all sorts of validations. We did tilt validations. We did a bunch of things to prove that really this was the correct structure. Jump forward a couple more years. Now, using direct detectors and using additional purifications, we now have this lovely 4.7 angstrom resolution map in which you can see the pitch of the alpha helices and separation of the beta sheets and stuff. So once you have a structure at this resolution, there's no longer any question of whether the overall shape is correct or not. You cannot get a high resolution structure if you have the wrong overall shape. So the only case where you really have difficulty with whether your structure is correct or not in general terms is when you're at very low resolution. Still, there are a bunch of validations that if you're at very low resolution, you need to perform. Now, the question we want to ask here is, if we go back in retrospect, so this is just showing the agreement, if we filter the really high resolution structure down to low resolution, you can see that it agrees pretty nicely with what we published in 2011, so we were actually correct. So the question is, if we look in retrospect at the data that we had in 2002 and the data we had in 2011, could we look at that data somehow and say, oh, this was bad data, we really shouldn't have processed it, and this was good data? Okay. So this is an example on the left of the micrograph from the bad structure, and this is an example of the micrograph on the right of the good structure. Now, if you had these two, I think everyone would probably agree that you'd say, well, I'd rather process this one than this one. But if you only had this one, you would probably look at it and you would say, hey, look at that, there is a particle. Look at that, there is a particle. There's a particle over here. You can pick out individual particles here. It looks fine. There's some speckle in the background. So it's not the ideal micrograph, but it doesn't look like there's anything obviously wrong with it, right? So just on fundamental grounds, you wouldn't be able to say, I want to throw that one in the trash. Okay. So now let's take a look at the power spectrum of those two micrographs. Now, I'll point out this was collected on a better microscope. This was actually collected on a Joel 1200, no FEG, Lab6 filament, and the data only went out to about 15 angstroms. This had data extending out to about 6 angstroms, even though we only managed to achieve about 15 angstroms with the structure. Well, 10 to 15, depends on how you look at it. So that's not the effect that we're looking at here, because really all we're looking at is the gross morphology. You know, is this shape correct or is this shape correct? And if we look at the power spectrum of this image, it peaks, the signal-to-noise ratio peaks at about 1.3, and here it also peaks at about 1.3. They seem to be almost identical in terms of power. So you'd say, well, I really don't have any basis for picking one data set over the other. So let's do the analysis a little differently. So instead of looking at the whole micrograph, we're going to box out particles. And instead of saying the noise is anything below, you know, below that line connecting the zeros, we're going to actually box out stuff that isn't particles and consider that to be noise. So definition of noise is a little bit shaky here. And this causes a lot of problems in a lot of papers doing computational stuff with cryo-EM. So on the one hand, the noise is really just pure noise from the microscope, you know, from the detector, from the microscope, that sort of thing. Just noise from the physics of the experiment. From the perspective of single particle reconstruction, however, noise is anything that isn't the particle. Okay? If it's not the particle, if it's some other thing in the image, if it's buffer, if it's the continuous carbon background, if it's anything else, that's noise from the perspective of the single particle reconstruction. So you see these papers that talk about, oh, well, we assume we have white noise, and the white noise is connecting the zero. Well, that's rubbish. That's not really what's the only things that are noise. There can be lots of other noise sources. So we box out these noise images, which contain just background, and we box out the particle images, and we can compare those. Now, there's a problem with this approach, which is, what if you have an image like this? I can box out all the virus particles easily, but I have a really hard time finding enough regions between the particles to box out enough noise to get a good characterization of the noise in this image. So the approach we've taken is like this. So we start out with a set of particles, and we build a Gaussian mask, which is about the size of the particle. And then we multiply that mask by each of the particles, and that gives us something which contains the particle and a little bit and the background noise, but it's mostly, you know, it focuses on the particles. Then we take this mask and we invert the mask so it looks like this, and multiply that by each of the images, and now we've pretty much masked out the particles. There's still a little bit left in the edges and stuff like that, but basically we now have something that is just background and not particle. There can be some problems with this if you have really high particle density, then the edges of other particles stick in on the edge and it'll look like noise, but generally speaking, the approach works pretty well. So we can use these little bits around the edges of the particles to estimate the noise. So if we do this, this is the power spectrum of the particles. Now you note this doesn't look as much like the CTF function anymore. Now it has these extra peaks in it and stuff. That's because we're computing the power spectrum with a particle in the middle of each box. So we're seeing the structure factor of individual particles now, not just sort of the structure factor of the overall micrograph. So it has a lot more features in it. And when we look at the noise, instead of seeing this smooth, flat curve I was showing you before, we now see the noise has a very strong oscillatory component. Now, there was no continuous carbon in this case, but there was detergent present in the buffer. And detergent molecules are very strong scatterers as well. They have formed these little micelles in solution. Even if you're below CMC, you still get, you know, occasional micelles, and it has a strong background. So it produces this oscillatory behavior. Okay. So previously, we were assuming the noise was here. So we're sort of taking a double hit. So previously, we said this was the noise, and this was the signal. So we were considering this previously to be signal when actually it's noise. Okay, so really the signal is just this and the noise is this. So we were massively overestimating our signal to noise ratio and some spatial frequencies. Now out here, this oscillatory part of the noise is actually becoming very small. So out here we probably weren't overestimating too much at all. So let's take a look at that. So now here is the spectral signal to noise ratio for the good particle measured on a particle basis. And this is what it used to look like when we just drew a line through the zeros of the CTF. So there were some places where we were overestimating the noise, but at low resolution where the contrast of the particle lives, we were actually dramatically underestimating the amount of signal that we had previously. Okay? Out here at high resolution, they're fairly similar to each other. Okay, let's look at the bad data. So previously of the bad data, we had this red curve and we said that it peaked at about 1.3. Look at what happened now on the particle basis. Our peak signal-to-noise ratio now is only 0.2, 5 times more noise than signal. Okay? So what happened is we were ignoring the fact that there was a lot of very strong background noise present in this data. So now if we look at the comparison before, we would have said, oh, look, these two are about equivalent. But if we do it on a particle basis, now we would say, oh my god, this data is massively better than that data. Our peak signal-to-noise ratio is above 1. I mean, it's getting up to the level of 3. Our peak signal-to-noise ratio here is 0.2, 0.3, so very tiny. So we can use this as a mechanism for looking at micrographs and estimating whether you should ever really do a reconstruction. We've done this on a dozen different specimens now, and it's fairly robust. So if you do this estimate and your peak signal-to-noise ratio is less than about 0.5, you probably don't want to try and process the data at all. If it's between 0.5 and 0.7 or 0.5 and 0.8, something like that, it's probably okay. And if it's bigger than 0.7 or 0.8, then the data should be fine to process. You should be able to at least align the particles accurately. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about CTF correction. So I showed you before the Wiener filter derivation. What we're going to do when we do CTF correction is basically exactly the same derivation, but now we're taking into account the functional form of the contrast transfer function. So we're asking the same question. Once I've averaged together a whole bunch of these noisy particles, how can I weight the different particles and filter the different particles to get the optimal 3D reconstruction out? Again, I'm not going to take you through the derivation, but the final answer looks like this. And this looks like a really awful, messy equation, but really it's not so bad. It just consists of three parts, okay? So we estimate the spectral signal-to-noise ratio of each micrograph, of the particles in each micrograph. That's the R sub I of S here, okay? This is the SSNR of a particular particle estimated from the micrograph. This is the sum of all the spectral signal-to-noise ratios. So this is the total signal-to-noise ratio you'd expect to get after averaging together a bunch of particles. So this final correction consists of three terms, three components. There is a Wiener filter component, and this is exactly like the original Wiener filter. This is an alternate way of writing it. In here it's signal-to-noise ratio divided by 1 plus signal-to-noise ratio. It's actually the same expression as we had before. It's equivalent. Then we have a CTF correction term, which is 1 over the CTF times the envelope function. So this function actually goes to infinity at certain spatial frequencies, but that's compensated for by this term here, which will go to 0 at the places where this goes to infinity, so it cancels things out. And then we have a signal-to-noise ratio weighting term here, and then we multiply that by the original image data. So this CTF correction scheme is pretty much what's used in all of the different software packages. I mean, it's not always exactly this formula, but if the math always works out, so it's pretty much equivalent in the different packages. Now, there are differences in how the different packages estimate the signal-to-noise ratio and that sort of thing. When SPIDER does it, they just assume the signal-to-noise ratio is some constant value, which makes it a little bit meaningless in a certain sense, but it prevents infinities from occurring. In Relion, they have a maximum likelihood formulation, but it works out to be basically equivalent to the same thing. Now, back to an example again. Here's an example of four different defocuses, which were carefully selected so they combine their information very nicely. If we add up all of those different defocuses, we see something like this. So if we did the phase flipping correction, if we took all the negative phases and we made them positive, and then we just averaged the images together without doing any other corrections, basically we've applied this sort of filter function to our final average. So we have a little bit of a high-pass filter, and we have this sort of oscillatory low-pass filter function going on. So the particle isn't going to be perfect, but it's at least it's not going to go negative and have things in the wrong place and stuff. Now, if we include the signal-to-noise ratio weighting term in this, if we have an accurate signal-to-noise ratio, we get a little bit of improvement. What that means is, basically, we can make slightly better use of our data by taking that signal-to-noise ratio weight into account, but it's only a slight improvement. If you don't do the signal-to-noise ratio weighting, it doesn't cost you all that much. It may be 20% of your particles or something. Once we've done the amplitude correction, then of course we take it, we fix all of this high-pass, low-pass filter effect, and we wind up with something which is basically a 1, meaning it looks just like the original particle that we started with without noise, and then it gets low-pass filtered based on this Wiener filter depending on the resolution of the reconstruction. Okay. Now, I want to finish off with a little discussion of faceplates as well. Since we saw a little bit about faceplates, so I'll say it a little bit again. So we have, at the NCMI, we have an instrument which is not quite unique, but there's only a handful of them around. So this instrument is equipped with faceplates and a faceplate holder. You can put the faceplates in at two different positions. You can put it in the back focal plane, or you can put it in down below in the different aperture position, basically. And the lenses are strong enough that you can shift you can shift the location where the faceplate's supposed to be using the lens adjustments in the microscope. Now, one of the nice things about this microscope is it also has an in-column omega energy filter. An answer to a question that you posed, you cannot put an omega filter in any FEI microscope. And the reason you cannot do that is because of patents. JOL patented the omega filter, and they do not allow FEI access to that patent. So JOL has a monopoly on the in-column energy filters, which is why the only available energy filter for FEI microscopes is the Gitan post-column filter, which doesn't produce as nice images because it does a right-angle bend, and the right-angle bend causes a preferred orientation in the images, which has some slight artifacts. So this energy filter is very nice. I mean, it produces very nice. There's no reason to ever turn off the energy filter. Whereas when you have the post-column filter, people turn it on or off depending on what they're trying to do with the instrument. So this has a phase plate. It has the energy filter, and it has a direct detector. So it's got all three of the contrast enhancing capabilities. And this is what the data Wah was showing the other day was collected on. So this is just a picture of a phase plate. So the phase plate normally goes in the back focal plane where the objective aperture normally sits. So you replace the objective aperture with a phase plate. And the phase plate basically consists of a thin carbon film, which is just the right thickness to cause a 90-degree phase shift, with a tiny hole in the middle. It's about 1 micron. These are built using focused ion beams. And it has to be very carefully centered in the beam. Now, this is a Zernike-style phase plate, not the new FEI holeless phase plate. So FEI is now making phase plates where you don't have to have a physical hole. where instead of having a hole, you charge the phase plate in a persistent fashion, and the charge in the phase plate at that location causes a phase shift. Now, interestingly, JOL also jointly owns the patent for that technology. They invented it before FEI with a group in Canada, but that patent argument hasn't quite been settled yet. So it'll be interesting to see what happens with the Volta phase plates when the legal issues come out. But the Volta phase plate is also very nice. It's much easier to use. The problem with these phase plates is you have to keep that hole centered into the central beam, and it drifts a little bit with time. So every time you collect an image, you have to recenter the phase plate. So you imagine if you're collecting a tomogram, those things Wah was showing that if you're collecting a tomogram with this Zernike phase plate, every image you have to manually recenter the phase plate. So you're taking a tilt series with 60 images in it. That means that for every image, you have to manually recenter it. So Wei Dai, who did all those experiments, spent months on the microscope. You know, every day she could collect maybe 2 tomograms. That's 8 hours sitting in front of the microscope to get 2 tomograms every day. It is a massive amount of effort. But these phase plates produce about a 4 to 5 times contrast improvement at low resolution. If you're looking at cells, you cannot match that using any other technique. Yes, you can also get a contrast boost from the direct detector. You can also get a contrast boost from the energy filter, but you're getting extra factor. This isn't 20% strong. This is 5 times more signal. The Volta phase plates only produce about a 2 times contrast improvement because the effect that they're using doesn't allow them to do quite as perfect 90-degree phase shift, and it changes with time, and it has all sorts of other things. So the Volta phase plates are much easier to use, and they can be automated, and they will probably win in the end because it's so hard to use these other phase plates, but you can get a lot more signal if you do it this way. Before I do the demo, I'll just show you the example, because I should be finishing up about now. So phase plates, they're great for small things because they can enhance contrast. They're great for whole cells, because you don't have multiple copies to average together in a whole cell. They're great for looking at dynamics where you get more contrast for each particle. Here's my example. So this is an example of CCT, which is a type 2 chaperonin. It's also known as TRIC, which has been labeled with an FAB fragment. The hope of this experiment was to figure out where specific subunits in the CCT were using the antibody label. The problem was we collected a bunch of images like this and we did the reconstructions and we couldn't find any antibodies anywhere. In theory, this was a very high affinity antibody, nanomolar affinity. Okay, so we should have seen antibodies, we should have seen 2 antibodies bound to each one, should have been great. In practice, when you use antibodies in electron microscopy, they don't behave as you would normally expect them to behave based on the biochemistry. So how do we answer this question? Why don't we see any antibodies? Turn on the phase plate. Ho ho, much easier to see. See these little dots floating around in solution? Those are the FAB fragments. If we look at the TRIC particles, you can see a few specific cases right there. There's an antibody sticking on the side of one. Right there, there's an antibody sticking off the side of one. There's one antibody sticking off there. But this is an extreme case. If you look at average in this of a bunch of micrographs from this system, you find that only about 10 to 15% of the particles have even one antibody bound. And we needed to have 2 bound to each particle. So basically, there's 0.1% or less particles would have 2 antibodies bound to the particle. So despite the fact that we thought we had a perfect antibody, it wasn't binding. So this is an example of where the phase plate allows you to answer a question you couldn't answer any other way. You can actually see on an individual particle basis whether the antibodies are there or not. So it's not something you necessarily need to do for the whole 100,000 particle data collection. It's just something you do to answer that simple question. Now let's just take a quick look at one more simulation, and then I'll stop. I'll go ahead and do it with that. Okay, so what happens when we have a phase plate? Okay, so this is our typical curves, CTF curve that we were looking at before. And, you know, of course, we can adjust it to focus, and we were saying we don't want to go close to focus because then our first maximum goes out to too high a resolution. So when we put a phase plate in, we get that 90-degree phase shift, and we go from almost no amplitude contrast up to all amplitude contrast. So I know that's a very funny terminology, right? In light microscopy, you normally see amplitude contrast, and you put a phase plate in to get phase contrast. in electron microscopy, we're doing the opposite thing. We normally have phase contrast, and we're putting a phase plate in to get amplitude contrast. So people talk about using phase contrast in electron microscopy. You're always using phase contrast in electron microscopy. When you put a phase plate in, what you're getting is phase plate contrast, or amplitude contrast. So we'll adjust our amplitude contrast up to 100%, and now you can see that the sine wave turned into a cosine wave. So now instead of being zero at the origin, it's one at the origin. And now, if I go close to focus, I can get very nice behavior all the way out to 3-point-something angstrom resolution. I don't have to do any phase flipping. I can do a sort of an inverse filter correction, and I can sort of get rid of my CTF correction and get these nice high contrast images. Now, there was a little mention of spherical aberration of the microscope. So you'll hear people in the community talking about using CS correctors on the microscopes. There's a couple of people in particular who are very strong proponents of CS correctors. Now, if you're using phase contrast, so we don't have our phase plate turned on, and you use a CS corrector, so we can set our C sub S to zero, and effectively it's very close to zero, the effect that that has is if we go very close to focus, instead of seeing, all right, let me adjust my scale here again. And I'll turn off that so we'll go out to really high resolution, or at least I'll lower it. Okay, so let me show you what happens when we get close to focus here. As we're getting closer to focus, it's just normal, and then eventually we'll see this ripple kind of coming in from this side and working its way back over here. Once we get to really small my CS is still set to zero. As we get to smaller and smaller defocus, we'll see this other ripple coming in from the right-hand side and interfering with the pattern. That causes this sort of Schetzer defocus phenomena here where we can extend the first zero out to high resolution, but it's also got this sort of funny behavior out here. If we turn off the C sub S, if we get a C sub S corrector, then the behavior at very small defocus becomes nice and smooth. We eliminate that extra effect. So that's got good sides and it's got bad sides. If you don't have a phase plate, it means that you've got no contrast at all here, so it's not very useful in that context. However, if we do have a phase plate, so again, if we have some spherical aberration here, whatever, it doesn't matter how big it is, and we go close to focus, we still have this effect that we can't get rid of. We can't ever get sort of a perfect function out of this thing. If we now turn off the spherical aberration, we can get really nice behavior here, and we can get it all the way out to sort of flat out to Nyquist frequency. So in theory, if you have a phase plate, which has the correct phase shift, combined with a C sub S corrector, you can envision a time when you could do atomic resolution microscopy without ever having to consider CTF or anything like that. I think that's probably of slightly limited benefit because actually doing CTF correction isn't really so big such a big deal, and because if you're using the Volta phase plates, you have this fact that you're getting this randomly changing phase shift. It's not really 90 degrees all the time. So there's a lot of things that which make this technologically difficult. But you know, 10 years from now, maybe that really is the way that all microscopes will be operating. On the downside, a C sub S corrector costs about $1 million. So it's not an inexpensive add-on to your microscope or something you'd buy on a whim. You pretty much want to justify it before you decide to add it on. Okay, I think, yes, that was it. Any questions?
Hi, Steve. That was an excellent talk. I was just curious about the Volta phase plate. You're saying is automated, right? So you don't have to adjust it.
It is capable of being automated. It is slightly automated at this point, but I'm not sure. I've heard different things from different people. We have a Volta style phase plate, which we also started playing with in our microscope, but it's not the Volta phase plate, so we don't have any of their automation stuff in place. So I don't have any direct experience with the automation side of it.
And it's not exactly 90 degrees, you're saying. So the
problem is you're charging a piece of carbon.
Right.
And as you're exposing it, it's charging more. So as you're using the phase plate, you're sort of gradually destroying it. And every so often, you have to move to a new area and charge it up again. And so the phase, so that the charge, which is causing the phase shift, is continuously varying as you image. So that means that if you try and go do perfect in-focus imaging, you're not really getting in-focus imaging because the phase shift is changing all the time. Mm. So the way they have to deal with it is you have to intentionally go out of focus, even though you're using a phase plate, because then the defocus curve allows you to monitor how much phase shift you're actually getting. So it's very it's messy in the computational side, but it's experimentally a lot easier.
And this is the one where there's a dispute between FEI and GATA.
Well, I don't know if it's actually a dispute. I know that there is a patent, and I know that there could be a dispute, but I don't know that JOL has actually raised the issue at this point in time.
Okay.
They apparently jointly own this patent with a university in Canada, so they may not have full control over.
Right.
You know.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, Steven.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Nice talk. This is general questions. Is there something similar to solvent flattening in crystallography to improve the paces which lost due to defocusing?
Something similar to, I missed the first.
Solvent flattening. In crystallography,
oh,
you use solvent
flattening. Yes. We do something like solvent flattening routinely. We call that masking.
What is that?
Masking.
Masking. Oh.
So when you do your iterative reconstructions, after you do a reconstruction, and then you mask it out, and you set everything outside the structure to zero.
Okay. Does it improve both the paces and signal?
Well, it's not solvent flattening in quite the same way. When you're talking about refinement in crystallography, there's an iterative process where you're adjusting the phases. In cryo-EM, the phases are already measured. So what we're improving iteratively in cryo-EM is the orientations of the particles. So by eliminating that extra solvent noise, we can get slightly better orientations in the particles. So in a sense, it's improving the amplitudes and the phases, but it's indirect. It's a real space phenomenon, not a Fourier space phenomenon.
Okay, my question is, because of defocusing, maybe you lost some paces. Because of defocusing, some paces might have lost. That can be improved through this type of method?
So when you defocus, information is lost at specific resolutions, but that information is filled in by micrographs taken at other defocuses. So you're never in a situation where we just don't have any information here. You always need to have some information at all spatial frequencies. So this is why picking the defocuses that you use in some form is correct. Oh, that was actually something I was going to say. So the practical advice, how do you pick your defocuses? You saw in my little example there that when I picked random defocuses, I still wound up with places where there was very low signal coming out. So if you pick 10 random defocuses or 15 random defocuses, you'll be fine. It'll fill in all the information. But if you pick 4 random defocuses and try to take defocuses at those 4 specific values, you could wind up in a situation where your resolution curve comes down and it goes down to 0, and then it sort of comes back up again because you're missing information in some range. So the normal advice that you give people when imaging is you go as close to focus as you can and still see the particles, and you treat that as sort of your baseline, and you go from that to focus to about 1 or 1.5 microns further from focus, and you collect data randomly over that range. But you should never go further from focus than that. There's some effects I didn't show you. If you go too far from focus and you have a small box size, it can actually be impossible to recover the information at high spatial frequencies.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, did I answer the question you asked too?
Okay. I got it, thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So different software takes different approaches to dealing with the CTF. I guess you're sort of indirectly referring to defocus groups that SPIDER uses.
Right. Yeah.
I don't, even in SPIDER, most people don't use defocus groups anymore. This was something that was come up with in 2001 or 2002 when they first started doing CTF correction. So if you look at Joachim and look at Paul Penchek, who developed that technique originally, they don't even use defocus groups anymore. It was a stopgap measure to fix a problem that they perceived at the time. So people who learned that method and are still using it now should probably rethink how they're approaching it. It can be made to work, but it's not a good approach. So data on different days is fine. You can just mix it all together. I mean, the only problem you'll have from one day to the next is sometimes you'll have issues with the magnification of the microscope altering a little or something like that. So if you have collected some data and then the microscope was serviced and you collect some data again, then there can be some conformance issues between those two sessions. But usually, if you just collect data for a week or something, there's no problem with one day to the next.
I have one question about the CTF correction.
Yeah.
Since I have also tried before, we find the first crossover on the CTF curve.
Yeah.
But when you have sometimes a little bit bump, it's in the programming part is still some tricks to judge where is the first cross. Can you share a little bit?
So typically the way things are done, so if you use something like CTFind 3 or 4 or blanking out on the other one, the new GPU one from the MRC. If you use those packages to estimate the defocus and the astigmatism, it's based on the whole micrograph using that sort of square scheme that we're averaging. And usually the noise has been averaged out in those situations enough that you don't have to worry about that too much. Usually the overall fit is fine. It's not too ambiguous. There may be some exceptions to the rule. It can be difficult if you're using a low-quality microscope and the signal doesn't go out to high resolution. There may not be a lot of zeros to fit, and you can have some problems still. EMAN also has the approach that we do it first on whole micrographs, and then when we deal with it when we do the particle basis, we're usually just sort of tweaking things a little bit. So there's an issue when you're doing it on the whole micrograph. The defocus that you see, say you have a continuous carbon substrate and particles floating around, the defocus you get is going to be the defocus of the carbon primarily. If the particles are floating significantly above the carbon, they may be at a slightly different defocus. And that won't be a problem at 15 angstroms or maybe even 10 angstroms, but it will be a problem when you get down to 4 angstroms or 3 angstroms sometimes. Mm-hmm. So in virus particles in particular, you see this be a fairly noticeable difference. So in that situation, using the particle-based approach can actually give you more accurate values because we subtract away the carbon and are left with just the defocus signal that comes from the particles.
Okay, thank you for that. One more small question. Just for, I asked you yesterday about the phase flipping for the CTF correction.
Yeah.
From my experience, sometimes we also do scaling for the phase amplitude part at a high angle a little bit, maybe like for a certain range, if we really do want the 3D reconstruction about. So do you include this in the EMAN too?
So that correction function I was showing is amplitude and phase correction. In EMAN, we split the phase flipping and the amplitude correction. We do the phase flipping as a pre-processing operation normally, and then we do the amplitude correction later
yes.
on at the end. You don't have to do it that way, and there are some schemes which people use, even with an EMAN, where they adjust the defocuses as part of the refinement procedure. Particularly on virus particles, Wen Zhang and Purdue has been doing per-particle defocus correction now. So that pre-processing of the phase flipping is not always a good thing, but it can save a little computational effort. There are some other things, like in Imagic, I know Marin Van Heel was a proponent of doing phase flipping on the whole micrograph, so you don't have to worry about any of those edge effects that you get when you do it on particles. I'm not sure. Does he still recommend that?
Yeah, I think I got the answer. I missed some part in your presentation. Now I remember.
Okay.
They separately, right? Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Do you have an add on? Is that true? Do you see? Yeah. Oh, okay. You don't want to talk about it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Oh. Okay. Fine.
Hey, Steve. Excellent talk. I have one question regarding what we call noise. In EM, so basically in EM we have these macromolecules,
yeah.
And then we have this background. But what about when we have small molecules and if the sample is slightly heterogeneous? Because as you mentioned that we have a background from the buffer.
Yes.
So what do you think? How can we actually kind of distinguish them? If you are looking to the small molecules, slightly heterogeneous, how can we distinguish them from the background?
So. Heterogeneous particles are the most difficult problem in cryo-EM, primarily because the contrast, you have to have enough contrast in each particle to separate the particles into groups accurately. right? So it's not just a question of the group population differences. It's a question also of each particle, whether you can tell which group it goes in. So for small particles, that is particularly difficult and in many cases impossible. So if you're in a situation where you have small particles that may be heterogeneous, you need to do everything you possibly can to improve the contrast. The way you do that is you use a good direct detector. You maybe use an energy filter if you've got one. You maybe use a phase plate if you've got one. And most important, you use very thin ice. This is almost always the biggest problem, is people get ice that's just a little bit too thick, and for tiny particles, that makes all of the difference in the world. Controlling the buffer can also help a lot. You don't want to put bad things in your buffer. Good things in the buffer in cryo-EM, salt is fine, but big buffer molecules, not so fine. So if you put detergent in your buffer, you won't be able to see your particles. You'll just see detergent. I remember an example from viruses where someone was using histidine as a solvent for some of their some of the viral spikes. And needless to say, if you have an amino acid as a solvent at high concentration, you don't see particles very clearly, because the particles are also amino acids. So the contrast is non-existent.
So if you go from pixel to pixel in an image, the intensity values difference between 0 to 255, right? So can you somehow kind of like make a difference mapping or something? If you have a signal of your particle and then you have the background?
No. That's sort of like the edge detection stuff that she was talking about only works when you have very high contrast particles. Most of the image processing methods that people use for like computer vision and stuff like that do not work at all for cryo-EM. People have tried to apply them for years and they only work in very exceptional cases. You need to take everything in these sort of situations is dealt with in Fourier space, where you have control over where the information is actually present in the image.
Okay, so I have some images. I will like to talk to you afterwards.
Fine. Okay, yes.
Thank you. Thanks.
So I had a question regarding CTF correction in negative stained images.
Yeah.
So technically, because we have the stain, we can just see our particles at absolute focus.
Yeah,
we don't
right, really. Sure.
So what would be the best, like you mentioned that for cryo images, the best defocus would be when you just start seeing the particles and then you...
So again, you go as close to focus as you can and still easily see the particles.
Right.
And then you go from that point to about 1 micron or 1.5 microns further from focus, and that's the range you normally would use. Don't bother taking images that are so close to focus that you can't see the particles. They won't be very useful.
So it's the same for negative stain images as well?
Well, for negative stain, some people in negative stain actually take images very far from focus, and I've never really understood that, because as you say, you can go to Schetzer defocus, and you can collect beautiful images if they're stained well. Mm-hmm. Now, this is actually the caveat, because a lot of people aren't very good, you know, they don't understand what good staining and bad staining looks like if they're new to it. So if you make nicely, if you get good staining, you should be able to go to Schetzer defocus, and then you don't really have to worry about it too much. I showed Schetzer defocus. That's the point where those ripples come in and the first zero falls off. There's a formula for it, but I don't think I want to give it to them. Here, we'll look at it again. Let me turn on the C sub S again. All right. So this is... Okay, so here as I'm going to, all right, let me change the range here. Okay, so as I'm going closer to focus, what we see is that funny function coming in from the right side of the image. And when that funny function intersects with the normal function and becomes kind of flat like that, Schetzer defocus is right in here. So it's the point where you get this sort of flat behavior at lower, oh, sorry, this is 100% amplitude contrast. Here we go. So Schetzer defocus is the defocus where we get this kind of flat behavior in here, and it lets us go out to a high resolution with pretty good contrast, and the first zero is way out here. If you go all the way in focus, then you start seeing this behavior, and it's not optimal again. Right? You get better contrast here than you do all the way in focus here.
Thank you.
Very nice. I have a small question before. This, when you do imaging at focus. Particles are there, in fact, isn't it? And it's not visible. For example, in crystallography, with the direct detectors, you don't see resolutions in the images, but when you do image processing, when you do pick up the index it and pick up the spots, you do actually go farther than what you see, actually, to very high resolution than what you see.
Yeah.
So is there any software that can say, suppose we have a defocus image and we have processed that image and we have a rough idea of how the particle looks like, and is there any software that can detect the presence of particles in the focus?
This is a very leading question. I hope you meant it in a leading way. I'm going to assume you meant it. So there are some particular examples in literature from a few years ago where people claimed they were doing that. There was a famous paper on the RNA trimer from HIV, which people are now talking about fairly openly, where a material scientist came into CryoEM and assumed he knew how to collect images for CryoEM because he knew how to collect images for material science, and took all of his images very close to focus. And then he developed a new algorithm to pick out, find the particles in the images which had this very, very low contrast, and he picked them out, and he said, look, I can prove these are really particles even though you can't see anything, and he reconstructed them and got an answer which was totally wrong. And he tried again and again for about 2 years to prove that he was right and everyone else was wrong, and was definitely proved that he was completely wrong, and it's just wrong, and they still don't admit it to this day. It is a very bad situation. You should not process images where you cannot see there are particles present in the image. I am not taking the standpoint that it is impossible to extract particles in situations where you cannot clearly see them. You can Wiener filter them, you can do wavelet processing. Sometimes you may be able to pull out data from images that are borderline, that are marginal, but it's never a good thing to do. I mean, it is a very risky thing to do, and you could easily put yourself in a situation where you turn yourself into a pariah, where you've published a structure which is completely wrong, and no one trusts anything that you publish anymore. It's not a good thing to do. Always come up with a strategy where you can see the particles before you process the data, would be my general advice.
So my question was like not picking when you're not seeing it. My question was, basically, is there an algorithm that can detect the position of particle at the focus using the images from the defocus?
Oh, I see. You want to locate the particles by taking a out of focus image
from the
and then pull out the data from the infocus image.
Infocus image.
Yeah, that's also question. A strategy that some people have used. It can be used successfully on some things like big virus particles, where it's hard to see them and close to focus, and you can see them better far from focus, and you pick them out, but I think it's largely an abandoned approach. That approach was used about a... I don't think Hong's doing that anymore.
No, not anymore.
Yeah. It was done back in like 2000 to 2005. A lot of people were doing that kind of thing. But the point is, on a FEG microscope, you don't really lose very much by going to 1 micron out of focus.
Right.
It doesn't really cost you much in the high resolution end.
Right.
With a good direct detector, you've got good signal. There's no reason to take images
to
that close
that.
To focus.
Right.
In general, it depends on the size of your complex.
True too.
In general, that has been the technique suggested by Hong Zhu.
Mm-hmm.
He was using that. It's really like Steve has mentioned, in 2000 or something like that. By that time, you didn't have direct detectors.
Yeah.
But nowadays, mostly we have, the beam was possibly not so coherent, but nowadays we have mostly, I don't know how big is your complex.
How small do you mean by small?
800 kilodalton complex.
800?
Yes.
Is that what you said? That's not small.
That's not small.
That's humongous.
800 kilodaltons. It's huge.
That's huge.
That's not a problem.
50 kilodaltons is small.
That's exactly the case. Even 100, okay, we can admit that it's possibly
it's not
have trouble.
I mean,
but 800, if it's growing out, it's So you can see it's very easily.
Yeah.
Yes.
You should not even, okay, defocus about 2 microns would be absolutely perfect.
Yeah. Yes.
There are plenty, there are examples now of people doing 80 kilodalton proteins successfully. So, I mean, we're pushing now down towards, you know, sort of 40, 50 KD without going really close to focus or anything like that.
So I just want to add this, actually, so I work on Legion-on. So what you can do, actually, you can go to a higher defocus value, okay, pick the particles, and you also take the same image at a very lower defocus value, close to the focus. So you, then you use the coordinates where you can see your particles on the lower defocus value images and pick those particles, basically.
Yeah.
So people does that in Legion-on. So they take 2 images at the same point, with a very lower defocus value and at very higher defocus value. Use the coordinates and pick those particles from the lower defocus value. Get the reconstruction. I don't know how much resolution you lose there.
So I agree that the technique does exist within Legion-on. It's the same thing that Hong Zhao suggested. Exactly. I don't think anyone's using it much anymore. If they are using it, they probably shouldn't
Steve,
anymore.
We try.
I think both you and me, both are making some mistakes. We are thinking of high-level microscopes. And people here, they have a low voltage microscope. But
if you don't have a field emission gun, then you can still get some advantage out of doing it.
Suddenly
that's true.
I have recognized why Natesh might raise this question.
Yeah,
since it's
maybe.
A slightly different, they don't have high level microscopes.
Even though with a non-FEG microscope, if you're only talking about going to, you know, say 1.5 microns or something, there's not much effect on the resolution.
Nonetheless, the last 7 years I didn't process such these images.
Yeah, the approach was added to Legion-on back in the time when it was being proposed, you know, a decade or more ago. And as far as I know, I don't think the Legion-on developers use that approach for anything anymore. I could be wrong. Maybe I'll get an angry email from Bridget, but I don't think so.
Thank you.
Very well. Thanks a lot for